It's the appointed time. We have a quorum. I call to order the meeting of the Bills Committee on Deposit Protection Scheme Amendment Bill 2024. Let us first invite the administration to join us. Welcome. We have with us Deputy Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury, Ms. Manda Chan, Mr. Justin To, Principal Assistant Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury, Mr. Donald Chan, Executive Director of the Hong Kong MA Monetary Authority, Ms. Carrie Chan, also from the Hong Kong MA, and we have Mr. Alan Lai and Ms. Poon from the Department of Justice. I need to ask members regarding the bill in question today. Do we need to hold a public hearing, or are we going to invite the public to express their views by way of written submissions? Thank you, Mr. Lee. Any more views? No. I understand the administration and the Hong Kong Monetary Authority have conducted public consultation sessions on the deposit protection scheme. If members agree, we can invite the public to submit written submissions. We'll ask the Secretariat to do so. We'll invite the public to submit written submissions. We'll allow 1 week for the public to express their views. I'd like to ask the administration to walk members through the bill, after which the floor will be open for questions. Ms. Manda Chan. Thank you, Chairman. The bill seeks to enhance the stability of the banking system and the improvement of the deposit protection scheme. The deposit protection scheme was set up in 2006. It is aimed at protecting depositors and contributing to banking stability. All licensing banks, even except they are exempted, are scheme members. With the concerted efforts of the banking sector and the relevant industry, the deposit protection scheme has been successfully run. There's no need to make any adjustments. Per depositor, the protection limit under the DPS is $500,000 per scheme member bank, covering around 91% of depositors. Today, the ratio has already dropped to 88 to 89% in recent years. That is below the international standard of 90%. In accordance with the international standards and the guidelines set by the relevant regulators, the DPS is reviewed regularly. The recent review was conducted in 2021. That is to ensure the standards are upheld or in line with the international standards. The DPS is still considered appropriate. 5 enhancement measures have been proposed. The bill is amended to cater for the amendment in these 5 areas. The protection limit will be increased from $500,000 to $800,000. That will protect 92% of depositors, which is in line with the international standard of 90%. The annual contribution will increase by 26%. This is a mild increase and is acceptable. The new protection limit will strike a balance between different factors. In relation to levy, there are 2 types of levy. 1, the build-up levy, which is higher. It is mainly used in the build-up phase of the DPS fund. After a certain period of time, an expected loss levy will be charged, which is a lowered levy. The DPS fund has already reached the target fund size, that is 0.25 of the total protected deposits. So starting from 2024, members make contributions based on the expected loss levy, which is the lowered levy. The protection limit is recommended to be raised from $500,000 to $800,000. It takes a decade to reach the new target fund size based on the expected loss levy, which might cause a negative impact on the credibility of the DPS. So we recommend amending Schedule 4 on the bill. So the DPS scheme members will have to be made to pay build-up levy. In 3 years' time, the target fund size will be reached, that is $8.2 billion. We also recommend adding 27A, B, and C. That is to enhance the mechanism in the case of bank merger or acquisition. According to the latest standard of the International Association of Deposit Insurers, IADI, upon merger of banks, the aim is to provide a transitional period so the scheme members can, depositors can consider adjusting their savings combinations. If depositors have savings in more than one merged banks, depositors will enjoy a protection of maximum of $800,000. So if the savings are up to $800,000, that depositor is subject to a protection limit of $1.6 million in total. In relation to the representation regime, we recommend adding Section 3 of the rules. That is, the membership sign needs to be displayed in their relevant places of business. In recent years, there are digital avenues or platforms. They have become the major avenues for delivering banking services. So it is proposed that scheme members are required to display the membership sign on their electronic platforms. We also recommend adding Section 6C, that is arrangements for the transaction of a non-protective financial product before any transaction of non-protective financial product take place. There is a negative disclosure requirement, and there needs to be an acknowledgement from the client. An example is that when scheme members enter into non-protected deposit transactions with institutional customers who are generally in a better position than retail depositors to undertake the risks of their investments. So the streamlined procedure should be extended from institutional customers to private bank customers. We recommend adding provisions so that the disclosure needs to be made on a one-off basis only. There should also be an annual reminder to the private banking customer. There should be two phases in relation to the implementation of the proposal. In phase one, the representation regime and the negative disclosure requirement are involved. The next phase will take place on the 1st of January 2025. That covers the display of their membership sign on their electronic platforms. That allows them to make preparatory work. Between July and October 2023, the DPS Fund already held public consultation exercises. There was broad support from the public. The next review may be taking place at a later time. So the DPS fund undertakes that the next review will be conducted in 2027, and the review will be completed in the following year. That concludes my introduction. We are glad to take questions from members. The floor is now open for questions. So members have 6 minutes, question and answers included. Members can ask in the second round. Mr. Li Chen Kang, thank you, Chairman. The DPS scheme has been operating for a period of time that cements Hong Kong's standing as an international financial center. When investors come to Hong Kong for investment or deposit savings, we enjoy the backing of the principle of one country, two systems for capital to flow freely in the market. The success is owed to the deposit protection scheme. I'd like to ask questions on two fronts. The IADI proposes 90% of the protection limit. What about other jurisdictions? Do they go beyond 90%, say 91%, 93%, or even 100%? Or do they simply meet the requirement of the standard of 90%? What are the pluses? Will the costs be in turn passed on to depositors? Otherwise, how should we strike a balance? We are in the process of economic recovery. Should we attract more foreign enterprises? Should we attract private banks? You mentioned private banks are not covered. Why is that? E-banking is very popular. You can open an account online. You just need to make the application online. What about these online banks? Ms. Manda Chen, please. Thank you, Chairman. The standard set by the IADI is 90%. So we use this standard as the target. We propose raising the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000, which will meet the requirement of 90%. The coverage is different. Take Singapore, the nearest country, as an example. The protection limit is some 92% in percentage terms. The UK and the US may be up to as much as 98% or 99%. We need to consider the stability of the bank, the banking system in these jurisdictions. These systems have not been activated. There is no need, reflecting the confidence in the banking system. In the US, however, there were banking failures, incidents. So there needs to be better protection in order to bolster public confidence in deposit protection schemes. There are different factors at play, as I mentioned. One, we need to align with the international standard. For scheme members, we also need to take into account the burden. When we raise the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000, banks need to shoulder, or banks are subject to a protection limit of 26%. That can protect the public, and that is also welcomed by the industry. Online banks are the same as physical banks. They are also covered. The savings are also protected under the deposit protection scheme. Two more questions. Will the new levies be passed on to clients? And what about private banks? Why are they excluded from this scheme? Thank you, Chairman.
For private banks, our proposal is that when they carry out transactions on non-protected financial products, we are going to streamline the negative disclosure procedures. For these private bank customers, if their products are protected under the DPS, they will still be protected by the protection limit of $800,000. That is, when transactions of non-protected financial products are carried out, the negative disclosure procedure can be streamlined. They won't have to listen to the reminders every time when they carry out the transactions. This is because for private banking customers, they have more knowledge and experiences on this type of transactions. That's why they don't have to listen to the negative disclosure during each transaction. How about the additional costs to be incurred? Mr. Chen, our view is that if the protection limit is not raised to a very high level, the additional costs will not be passed on to the depositors. That's why we're not proposing a significant increase of the protection limit. Well, it is up to individual banks to make their own arrangements, but we think that a 20-some percent increase is not significant. Chairman, if there is an increase, will the information be disclosed to the customers of the banks? I don't think there will be relevant disclosure, as far as I understand. Well, there are many ways through which banks can pass on the additional cost to their depositors. They may not be passed on to their customers or depositors in the form of an insurance or deposit costs. Dr. Tan Yueheng. Thank you, Chairman. The enhancement measures proposed under the deposit protection scheme include raising the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000. I welcome this proposal. I have three questions. First, by raising the protection limit from $800,000, the target fund size would be $8.2 billion instead of some $6 billion. And the target fund size should be 0.25% of the total deposits. So 0.25%, is it a standard set based on international practice or standards? Is 0.25% a prudent standard? This is my first question. Second, the DPS currently does not cover Octopus card or other types of value storage tools. But they are all considered as form of deposits. So for value storage tool operators, they have to have risk management measures. It is only with such risk management measures that when depositors require the deposits back, then the storage tool operators can pay them back. Are there any loopholes currently in relation to this type of tools? Well, since is it an international practice that such value storage tools are not covered by the DPS? Chairman, I ask Mr. Donald Chan from the HKMA to take the questions. I'll respond to the questions in Cantonese. On deciding on 0.25%, whether it is in line with the international standards, well, Normally, we make reference to practices in different jurisdictions, or we base on the practices or situations. For instance, we take into account the default rate of banks and how great a chance will the bank be able to recover the asset value. For instance, we take into account different scenarios or factors. For instance, there may be up to 100 million scenarios when we come up with such a percentage. The percentage may vary in different places. This is because the reference values in each place is different. The default rate of banks in different countries or places may vary. 0.25% is not a very high percentage compared to other jurisdictions. The other question is about stored value facilities. It is right that stored value facilities aren't covered under the DPS. My understanding is that this is in line with practices in other places. It is not unique to Hong Kong. With the $8.2 billion target fund size, how are you going to use the money? Are you going to make investments? We are going to make investments because there may be possible payouts from the DPS fund. So the HKDPB is going to make investments on its own. Is that right? Yes. You mentioned that 0.25% is not a high percentage. Well, how are we faring compared to other jurisdictions? Is it a high percentage or is it below average? Well, do you think the risk management level is adequate? Well, compared to other places, 0.25% is slightly lower. It reflects that our banking system is robust. That's why the percentage is low. We assume that we won't see high risks of, for instance, bank failures. That's why we set a relatively low percentage. You mentioned that stored value facilities aren't covered by the DPS because they have their own risk management measures. And you also said that in other places, such stored value facilities aren't covered in the DPS. We have another mechanism to regulate stored value facilities, or SVF. As the regime continues to evolve, we will see if the risk management level is adequate for SVFs. Dr. Tan, I thank the HKMA for answering my questions. Mr. Robert Lee, I welcome and support the proposals, that is to raise the protection limit from 500,000 Hong Kong dollars to 800,000. This will enhance protection for depositors, and this will also enhance public's confidence in the local banking system. I have a couple of questions that have to do with the public's perception of the scheme as well as situation faced by non-financial institutions. How can we allow the public to How can we let the public know that the protection limit will be raised to $800,000 for IPC in the US? The limit is $50,000. For FTIC, the limit is up to $250,000. I understand that we have to strike a balance here. And in the US, there were a number of bank failures. In Hong Kong, our banking system is relatively more robust and stable. However, the public may see that the protection limit in other places is much higher. How can we explain to the public why there is such a difference? For securities operators or non-financial institutions, they don't set the same level, and this may cause a public misconception. For security firms in Hong Kong, well, some of them raised the protection limit from $150,000 to $500,000. Well, now that banks in Hong Kong are going to raise the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000, and this will give people the impression that securities firms are offering lower protection. They may have to increase it to a high level from $500,000. How can we allow the public to know that whether they place the deposits in security firms or banks, it's equally safe? I think we have to explain more to the public about this. Also, I understand that you are going to require scheme members to display the DPS sign. I hope there can be similar arrangements for non-financial institutions. So that global or international investors, as well as local depositors, know that they will be protected under the scheme. Will the administration respond to the alignment of arrangements between non-financial regulators in Hong Kong as well as banks here? Administration. As mentioned in my opening remarks, the HKDPB conducted a public consultation between July and October last year. There was a questionnaire survey, and members of the public have certain level of understanding about the DPS. They supported the raising of the protection limit to $800,000 because it will help catch up with the inflation rate since 2011. Also, more depositors will be protected under the proposal. 92% of the depositors will be covered under the scheme. Also, the proposal will help maintain the robustness of our banking system. So members of the public have certain confidence in the proposals as well as the DPS. We aren't worried that members of the public aren't clear about the protection they get under the scheme as well as the difference between our scheme and that of other jurisdictions. After we've enhanced the arrangements and measures, after the bill is passed by the Legislative Council, we will step up a publicity campaign. I will invite Mr. Chen from HKMA to tell you more later. On securities firms as well as non-financial institutions, their deposits aren't covered by the DPS. It's under the purview of the SFC. Member just now gave us some suggestions on how we can minimize the impacts on non-financial non-financial institutions as well as securities firms after our enhancement measures are rolled out. How can we balance the views of the public on security firms as well as banks? Can we roll out a similar arrangement, that is to require security firms to display certain signs? Well, we will look into this. I now invite Mr. Donald Chan to tell you or respond to other questions. Like Ms. Amanda Chan said, we will step up publicity after the bill is passed. We will do it through our social media platforms, TV programs, as well as through radio channels. In the past, at the central market, as well as in shopping malls, we set up booths and counters to educate public about the deposit protection scheme. we have been monitoring how much the public know about the scheme. We found it encouraging because recently over 80% of the citizens tell us that they know about the scheme.
Next, Ms. Carmen Kan. Thank you, Chairman. I'm a member of the DPS, and I also work for the Bank of China. According to the standard of the IADI, we are right now below the standard. So through the enhanced scheme, our protection limit will be enhanced. Member also asked, why not the higher the better? In the document, in the footnotes, they mentioned a balance has been struck between protection of depositors and the cost of scheme members. It is not necessarily the higher the better. There are more risks entailed. So I'd like to know from the administration more about the perspective of moral risks. Moral hazard risks are mentioned in footnote number 3. What kind of moral hazard risks will follow? Right now, there is no adjustment to 0.25%, but as a result of the larger protection limit, the target fund size will increase from $6.3 billion to $8.2 billion. Based on the two-tier levy mechanism, that is the build-up levy, we have finally reached the expected loss levy in 18 years' time. Upon the passage of the bill, we'll move back to the build-up levy once again. In the footnotes, we learned that the levies is different in the sense that the build-up levy is larger, or is higher, I mean. It depends on the rank of the banks, and the range remains unchanged. The expected loss levy, which is a lower one, we can move back to the higher levy, that is a build-up levy. As Manda mentioned, it takes a decade to move to the expected loss levy, that is $8.2 billion. But it only takes 3 years to reach the build-up levy. I mean the target fund size. I'd like to know, is that the case that we cannot use the build-up levy right now, so we need to make the relevant amendments? Right now, we propose raising the limit from $500,000 to $800,000. If we raise the protection limit such that all the depositors receive protection 100%, there will be more hazard risks. In footnote number 3, it mentions an extreme scenario. Depositors do not have to worry anymore. That is, no matter what situation about banks arise, their deposits will also be protected. But banks may resort to high-risk behavior in order to attract more customers. For example, they may offer a higher interest rate in order to attract more customers. Competition among banks will give rise to risks as a result of this kind of competition. I will ask Mr. Ronald Chan to give you more information. The IADI's standard is that as long as 90% of the depositors are protected, the requirements are met. In relation to the target fund size of the DPS fund. Currently, the standard is set at 0.25%. Ms. Carmen Kan's understanding is correct. Right now, all scheme members also comply with the requirements and make contributions accordingly. But under the existing regulations, if the figure of 0.25% is not changed, only the expected loss levy will be charged to bank. So we recommend amending the existing regulations so that the DPB can charge the build-up levy from scheme members. The purpose is to achieve the target fund size more speedily. The IMF has already reminded Hong Kong within a reasonable time frame, Hong Kong should reach the target fund size of the DPS fund. More about the moral hazard risks. Mr. Ronald Chan, thank you. Ms. Mena Chan has already explained quite clearly from the perspective of depositors. If there is full protection, whichever bank's depositors deposit their savings, so you can imagine depositors do not have to make a judgment as to which banks they should deposit their savings. So banks may engage in excessively high-risk behavior. No matter what happens, when the savings of depositors are protected, they are more inclined to shoulder greater risks. For example, banks may attract more clients or depositors with a higher interest rate. It will result in a loss of market force. That's exactly why we need to strike a balance. Mr. Benson Lok, thank you, Chairman. I agree and support the raising of the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000. In the documents prepared by the Legislative Council, in paragraph 13, when the protection limit is set at 800%, the protection limit will reach 91%. However, the percentage of total protected deposits was only 25.2%, far lower than the figure seen in other countries, that is ranging from 67 and 79%. Is there any concern among banks? The government would like to draw for talents. Protection limit is a factor in whether talents would like to come to Hong Kong. Studies show that the raising of the protection limit of the DPS is a factor as well. Seven banks support raising the protection limit to $800,000. Another 17 banks agree with increasing the protection limit to $1 million. A balance should be struck in relation to annual contributions as well. So I'd like to know more about the balance being struck. How did you arrive at the figure of $800,000? Many banks said that the figure could be as high as $1 million. So why did you set the figure at $800,000? Ms. Mena Chan, thank you, member. 92% of the depositors will be protected when the protection limit is increased to $800,000. So the percentage will reach 25% in relation to the total protected deposits. Hong Kong is an international financial center. Many members of the public have a large asset portfolio. When 92% of depositors are protected, it means 8% of the depositors are not protected completely. For these 8% of depositors, They have a very large asset portfolio. Hong Kong's situation is unique compared with other economies. The figure of 8% reflects that Hong Kong has more high-value personnel. The DPB has already looked into the situation. It is of the view that the mechanism is suitable for Hong Kong. It can achieve the aim of protecting general depositors. So it is not recommended that the protection limit be further increased. The Hong Kong Bank Association has received views from banks to further increase the protection limit to $1 million. Indeed, these views have been received. But after striking a balance, as we said, we need to protect depositors, general depositors, to meet the international standards. That's how we set the standard. But of course, the higher the protection limit, the better depositors will feel. But then the IADI only recommends raising the protection limit to $800,000. But I can invite Mr. Donald Chan to give you more information. Thank you, Chairman. Some banks suggest raising the protection limit to $1 million. I've been in touch with these banks. The major grounds are that for some wealthier clients, the counterbargain is at $1 million. That's why they propose $1 million as the protection limit. If we need to wait for 5 more years until we conduct the next review, probably we can increase the protection limit further. That is the ground they put forward. Well, we cannot consider from the perspective of market competition. We need to consider which kind of protection limit is suitable. They are worried that we need to wait for a longer period of time before we can conduct another review. There has been active discussion in relation to the deposit protection or protection limit. The international coverage of 90%, is that still enough? Do we need to set different standards in relation to the types of accounts? There's no conclusion drawn yet. It's still the onset of the start of the discussion. It takes time before we can decide whether we need to make adjustments in the future. Just now, Ms. Manachan already said we will conduct reviews not 5 to 6 years later. Instead, we'll conduct a review 3 years later, which will be completed by the end of the year. In relation to striking a balance, just now, as Ms. Manachan already mentioned, we need to weigh up the cost effect. If we further increase the protection limit to $1 million, the number of fully protected depositors will only go up by 1.3%. That is a mild increase. But the protection limit will increase from $6.3 billion to $10.9 billion, an increase of 70%. That is not proportionate. Thank you, Chairman. Next, Mr. Chen Pui-Leung. I also support the raising of the protection limit to $800,000. I have questions on two fronts. Contributions need to go up by 26% owing to the increase in the protection limit. That is a mild increase and it is acceptable to banks. However, the compliance costs as well as other fees are significant, including the license fees. The increase is a double-digit figure. Will the increase in the costs pass the costs on to consumers or clients of the banks, particularly to small to medium-sized depositors who have low bargaining power? Will they be affected? Another question of mine is that the target fund size needs to increase to $8.2 billion. Then we need to resume the collection of the build-up levy. The papers show that it is actually dependent on the rank of banks. As I understand, that will depend on the supervisory rating assigned by the Hong Kong MA. For small to medium-sized banks, when the risk factors are high, the levies are higher, will that affect their competitiveness in the market? Would that give rise to unfair competition? That's my question. Thank you.
Two questions. Ms. Amanda Chan, please. Thank you, Chairman. An increase of 26% of contribution to be paid is moderate and manageable. Whether banks will pass on the additional costs incurred after the protection limit is raised to $800,000 to their customers, we think that such chance is small. In terms of the increase of licensing fees, well, the HKMA has consulted the trade and the industry finds it acceptable, that is the level of licensing fees being charged. So the compliance costs will increase with the raising of the protection limit as well as the increase of licensing fees, but banks in general find this increase manageable. The Hong Kong Association of Banks has reviewed the proposal. It's going to support the proposal, and after the bill is passed, it will help implement the arrangements and measures. And the trade is, in general, supportive of the proposals. In terms of the levy system, as mentioned, the levy system will remain unchanged. The rules have already set out the details of the levy system. With the levy system remaining unchanged, there won't be unfair situations. As to the question about the supervisory rating, I will invite Mr. Donald Chen to tell you more. Well, I don't have anything to add on this point because I cannot tell you which banks are assigned what supervisory rating. But we look at the deposits placed in a bank to assign a supervisory rating. In general, small and medium-sized banks are not assigned a very high supervisory rating because of the smaller amount of deposits. For larger banks, they may have to pay a higher levy, though. How often do you review the supervisory rating? We review it annually, so you only keep it to the banks. Only banks are aware of the supervisory rating. Mr. Edmund Wong. 6 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. On the question about moral hazard, well, the administration explained about the relevant risks from the regulatory body's perspective. How are you going to control or contain the moral hazard risks? The other questions is about the raising of the protection limit to $800,000. Some expressed the view that the limit can be raised to $1 million. But the administration explained that the review used to be done once every 6 to 7 years. But now that you're going to do it once every 3 years, then I guess this is reasonable because the target fund size will have to be reached to a certain level. So I'm glad that the administration said a review will be held once every 3 years. The other question is about the build-up levy. If we are to raise the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000, what would the target fund size be for each bank in order to support the raising of the protection limit to $800,000? Ms. Manda Chan, please. I thank Mr. Edmund Wong for the suggestions. One of the questions asked is about what the regulatory body should do. Well, I'll ask Mr. Chan to tell you more. The other question is about a levy. Well, we are to raise the protection limit to $800,000. So the target fund size will be raised from $6.3 billion to $8.2 billion. If we charge the build-up levy, we will be able to reach the $8.2 billion target fund size in 3 years' time. Mr. Donald Chan, about what the regulatory body should do. Well, this is a huge topic. Well, a large part of our regulation system on our banking system is about containing moral hazard risks. We conduct day-to-day supervision on the compliance of banks, as well as regulating the liquidity of capital. The other part that we look at is public education, how members of the public should choose banks when they place their deposits, for instance. It's about striking the right balance. If we look at the deposit protection scheme, we should try our best to control the moral hazard risks. On one hand, we should try to cover as many depositors as possible under the scheme. On the other hand, we want to take into account IADI's guidelines so that we can control the moral hazard risks. Ms. Carmen Khan, speaking for the second round. Chairman, I want to ask about cases in the event of bank mergers and acquisitions. Say two or three scheme members are involved, and if the protection limit is raised to $800,000, then depositors will, within 6 months' time upon the bank mergers and bank acquisitions, will be protected. Say if two banks are involved, the depositors will get compensation of $1.6 million, and if three banks are involved, the amount will reach $2.4 million. How will scheme members notify the affected depositors? Will such notification mechanism be reflected in the provisions under the bill? My other question is about the operation of banks. Well, currently there is a mechanism under which within certain days banks will have to take certain actions. I want to make sure that such a mechanism will remain even with the new proposals. My other question is about negative disclosure. Say a bank at its counters display the DPS scheme sign. Well, if that bank has electronic platforms, then such a sign will have to be displayed on the platform as well. So this is not only restricted to physical banks, but also virtual banks. Say if a product is not a protected deposit, then negative disclosure will have to be made. That is if the financial product is not subject to the $800,000 protection limit, then negative disclosure will have to be made. However, for investors or institutional customers, it may be annoying every time they get such a reminder or negative disclosure. I learned from the paper, paragraph 19, that under certain circumstances, such disclosure is only made on a one-off basis, and some jurisdictions do not even require such a negative disclosure to be made. I want you to ensure members of the public that even without such a negative disclosure, that we can continue to maintain our competitiveness and that we are in line with other international financial centers in the world. Ms. Amanda Chen, I will tell you again the new proposals. Under the new proposal, we're going to introduce new provisions under the bill. When scheme members, they carry out bank mergers or acquisitions, scheme members, before the merger or acquisition take place, well, they will offer protection to depositors for 6 months' time. That is, within the 6 month period, depositors will have their deposits protected. The purpose of this is that depositors can consider whether they wish to adjust their deposit portfolios, that is to reallocate part of their deposits to another bank. One simple example, as raised just now and also mentioned by Ms. Carmen Khan, within the 6 month period, the deposits placed in the banks involved in the merger and acquisition will be protected. Of course, the protection limit will not be higher than $800,000. We are going to implement the new proposals in two phases. The new proposal in the event of bank merger or acquisition will come into operation starting from the 1st of January this year, next year, to give enough time for banks to be prepared. We have looked at the situations in Canada, Singapore, the mainland, Germany, as well as Malaysia. In Singapore and the mainland, they do not require banks to make negative disclosure. Say in the UK, the US, Germany and Malaysia, when banks make negative disclosure, they only do it on a one-off basis and they have to obtain the acknowledgement from their clients. So under the new proposal, banks will only have to make such negative disclosure on a one-off basis. Mr. Edmund Wong, speaking for the second round. Thank you, Chairman. The administration mentioned that the target fund size will have to go up from $6.3 billion to $8.2 billion. So how much contribution will banks have to make under the new proposal? Because this will affect the liquidity as well as the operation of banks. Let's see if Mr. Donald Chen from the HKMA can disclose such figures. Well, I just want to get an idea. For smaller banks with the increased protection limit, there will be an increase of $100,000 or so, or a few hundred thousand dollars in terms of the contribution that they have to make. Mr. Wong, are you happy with the answer? I guess it's all right. Well, I am afraid that I cannot disclose further details to you here. Any other questions concerning the policy? If not, we will start the clause-by-clause scrutiny. I have a few questions. I believe Ms. Amanda Chen as well as Mr. Donald Chen can take this opportunity to respond to the concerns of the public. Currently in the US, the protection limit is about 2 million Hong Kong dollars. In the UK, the figure is about $910,000. So there is a gap between Hong Kong and compared to other jurisdictions. Well, we have just had the discussion that it's not like the higher the better, but we understand that the $800,000 limit is derived after internal discussion. Can you explain why there is such a big gap between us and, say, the UK and the US? Mr. Benson Luke mentioned that the depositors covered reached 92%, and the total deposits covered or protected reached 25%. If we raise the limit to $800,000, what will be the percentage of depositors that will be covered under the scheme? Well, our distribution of depositors are different from other countries, so it's not like it's going to be better if we surpass other jurisdictions. And also, why are you going to charge a levy for 3 years with the target fund size increase? Is it because you find that the 3-year window appropriate?
Thank you, Chairman. I'll take the first and the last questions from you. Regarding the test about the 25% of the total deposits, I will invite Mr. Donald Chan to give you more information. To raise the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000, there are 3 factors at play. One, we need to align ourselves with the international standard. That is the standard of 90% recommended by the IADI. The number of fully protected depositors will increase from the existing percentage to 92%. The total protected deposits are $500,000. It's been implemented for close to 2 decades. The accumulative inflation rate has reached 39%. The growth is 60%. So we have already caught up with the inflation rate from 2011. When the protection limit is increased, the extent of the contributions payable by banks will also go up. To banks that need to make contributions, the amount goes up by 26%, and that is manageable. Based on these factors, we propose raising the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000. Comparing with other jurisdictions, especially the US, there's a great difference. But in my introduction, I already said that the factors at play in relation to different protected depositors vary. There are different factors as well, such as bank failures and so on, that will affect the level of confidence in the DPS. But the DPS has not been activated since. I mean, it has not been activated at all. Regulation has been carried out well, so the growth isn't acceptable. Regarding the build-up levy, which allow us to reach the target fund size in 3 years, there is no international standard. The IADI does not specify how quickly we can reach the target fund size, but in 3 years' time, we can reach this target based on the build-up levy. We think this time frame is acceptable. The IMF also recommended that Hong Kong should reach the target fund size so that the banking system can maintain its stability in order to maintain the level of public confidence in the banking system. These are the factors we have considered. Mr. Donald Chan, the floor is yours. $500,000 covers 20%, and when we increase to $800,000, the protection coverage will increase to 25.1%. Comparing with the US, for instance, our ratio is lower. I don't have a lot of figures about the US, but I guess that the figures will go beyond 50%. Economic structures vary from one country to another. We are service industry-led, especially the financial industry. We also have a smaller population. So we have a higher ratio of high net worth investors or depositors. I mean, if the protection limit is to increase to $1 million, what about the percentage? Only an increase of 5% from $800,000 to $1 million. Well, I can go all over again. From $500,000 to $800,000, an increase of 25.1%. But when we go from $800,000 to $1 million, the percentage will only edge up by 2% to 27.8%. Thank you, Mr. Chen. Ms. Manda also said that there is no international standard. But when you collect levies in a period of 3 years, if you are going to lengthen the period of levy collection, people will find it easier to accept the raising of the protection limit. You mentioned it would take about $10 billion to increase from $800,000 to $1 million. Will it take more than 3 years? It may be worthwhile to look into it. The target fund size has not been used at all. It's been with the DPB all along. Just now, Dr. Tan also asked about investments. When a DPB makes investments, there is income and which will help the fund grow in size. I hope you will consider different factors as well. Next, we'll move on to clause-by-clause scrutiny. We'll go with the Chinese version, and the legal advisor will at the same time look at the English version of the marked-up copy. So, PAS, Mr. Justin To. Thank you, Chairman. The Secretariat has already helped prepare the marked-up copy. But before that, let me first talk about other provisions. I will first start with the provisions. The bill aims to amend the Deposit Protection Scheme Ordinance and its subsidiary legislation in Part 1, Preliminary, Short Title, and Commencement. The ordinance comes into operation on the 1st of January 2025. This part in sections 4, brackets 2, and brackets 4, 7, 10, 11, 14, brackets 3, 16, brackets 3, and so on will come into operation on the 1st of October 2024. I will also touch upon a few provisions in a moment. Section 10 and 11 are about transitional provisions. In section 14, brackets 3, and section 20, brackets 4, are about reference to $500,000 and $800,000. For sections 7 and 18, they are about the private bank customers negative disclosure requirements. In section 2 enactments amended, if members have no objection, I will use the marked up copy. Any questions from members? No. Justin, please continue. I will move to the amended parts. Page 5 of the markup copy, a footnote is added. A note located in the text of the ordinance is provided for information only and has no legislative effect. And most footnotes are about the other qualifying requirements such as bank merger and acquisition. We add this in order to enhance the readability of the legislation. On page 6, in paragraph 27, there are revisions to the provisions that is from $500,000 to $800,000. There is also another amendment. We add subject to the specified provisions. We will touch upon bank mergers and acquisitions. For bank merger and acquisitions, if a mechanism needs to be activated, that is the resolution regime for financial institutions, we take this opportunity to add the footnote and the provisions. So readers do not need to refer to multiple ordinances in order to make out our method of handling the relevant situation. On page 7, we have added section 27A. That's about the interpretation of sections 27A, B, and C. We have added a couple of definitions such as excluded transfer. It means a transfer by way of a property transfer instrument within the meaning of Section 2 of Schedule 4 to the Financial Institutions Resolution Ordinance. There are also interpretations about qualifying arrangements, transferors, and so on. We have explained these in Section 3. Immaterial date. It's about the starting date of the six-month period. So basically, when the arrangement takes effect, the material date will kick in. Regarding transfer, please refer to subsection 3. Section 4. These are seen in other parts of the ordinance. Some deposits are held by trustees or passive trustees. On page 9, section 27B, we introduced a time-limited enhanced protection limit following qualifying arrangement of scheme members. In subsection 1, a qualifying arrangement takes effect and the material date of the arrangement falls on or after the 1st of January 2025. In subsection 2, in other parts of the ordinance, $800,000 is to be construed as a reference to the enhanced protection limit. In subsection 3, it's about the expiry of 6 months. That is the expiry of 6 months beginning on the material date. Sometimes the time savings or time, the original deposits may be longer than 6 months. And the 6 month period will be extended. In subsection 4 A and B, it's about the $800,000 calculation method. And for time savings, accumulation of interest may be involved, and there are separate provisions to handle it.
12页.
Page 12 of the marked up copy, section 27C, notice to depositors about enhanced protection. It asks that when there is bank merger or acquisition, the bank would have to notify the depositors or customers what they are going to do with the qualifying arrangement. The copy of the letter that the bank involved would issue to the customer will have to be submitted to the board. And it also sets out under what circumstances the scheme member would commit an offense. And there is a penalty involved if the scheme member does not notify the board of the qualifying arrangement. Ms. Carmen Khan, I'd like to ask about section 27B, page 9 of the marked up copy. According to the administration, the upper limit of the enhanced deposit protection will be rolled out and the new arrangement will take effect starting from the 1st of January 2025, whereas the other provisions will take effect in 2024. For bank mergers or acquisitions that took place before this date, how would the administration handle such situations? Can the administration use an example to illustrate this? Say a depositor's time deposit lasts for 1 year, and then in between a bank merger or acquisition takes place, how would the depositor concerned be affected? Two questions. To answer the first question, if before the 1st of January 2025, the bank merger or acquisition took place, then the protection limit would be $500,000. So the new arrangement where all banks involved will offer compensation or protection will not happen yet. Is that right? Right. On cases where the time deposits are involved, you can look at it this way. Under subsection 4B2, the limit is $800,000. Say the deposit involved in a bank is $800,000. Then for each of such sum of deposits, they would be protected. And based on the number of accounts, the sum would aggregate. Under normal circumstances, the protection will only last for 6 months. That's a scenario A. But for scenario B, if the original maturity date falls after the 6 month period, then the compensation or the protection period will last over 6 months. So we look at the amount of deposits involved, as well as the number of bank accounts involved, and the expiry of the original maturity. We also will look at the cumulative interests. Say, three banks are involved in the bank mergers or acquisitions. The compensation will go up in accordance with the number of banks involved. Say this provision is going to take effect starting from the 1st of January next year. And if on the 5th of January, at Bank A, $1 million of deposit is involved, and for Bank B, $2 million is involved, and it is a time deposit that will last for a year. In the event of bank merger or acquisitions, within the 6 month period upon the bank merger, that is until the 5th of July, the protection limit at Bank A will go up to $800,000, even if the deposit is just $1 million. For Bank B, the protection limit will also be up to $800,000. But my question is that the time deposit would last for a year. Does that mean the $800,000 protection under Bank B would be lengthened? Say the time deposit will expire on the 31st of December 2025. Does that mean the protection under Bank B will continue after the maturity date or after the merger? So even if the deposit involved is $2 million and there is an interest of $100,000, but the protection limit would just be up to $800,000, right? Legal advisor, anything to add? Nothing to add, thank you. Justin, please carry on. We've just covered page 12, section 27C. Now we move on to page 13 of the marked up copy. There's a footnote to be added. For compensation under section 27, bracket 1 or bracket 2, well, there are specified provisions in relation to bank mergers and bank acquisitions and parts about the $800,000 protection limit. So we're adding a footnote here to make it clearer. Page 16 of the marked-up copy, the amendment also involves the raising of the protection limit from $500,000 to $800,000. Page 17, we are proposing to add under Section 50 the wording 27C bracket 3. This is about scheme members having to submit a copy of the letter issued to its clients to the board. And we are proposing an exemption clause here. And Section 50A is about reasonable excuse. In recent years, when we draft provisions like these, we normally include reasonable excuse or defenses. So this part is about that. Now page 18, we are adding section 58 about transitional provisions. If specified events take place before the 1st of October 2024, this is before the taking of effect of the raising of the protection limit, then the protection limit will still be $500,000. And there are also provisions concerning the protected deposits. And so this part sets out the protection limit. Please pause here, Mr. Edmund Wong. I'd like to ask about page 17 about the newly added section 50A, reasonable excuse. Why is the administration adding this new section, which was not included in the original ordinance? Mr. Poon or Ms. Poon? This is an exemption clause. This is included in section 32, 42, 44, and 48. We included parts about reasonable excuse in all these sections. And such reasonable excuse is commonly seen in different legislations. As we drafted this bill, the colleagues from the prosecution department gave us a legal advice. That is to facilitate prosecution as well as public understanding. If members of the public want to use reasonable excuse as a defense, then what would be the standard of proof or the burden of proof? These are all commonly seen concepts mentioned in the court, and we try to put it in simple words here. Say, when we have to use reasonable excuse under the Deposit Protection Scheme Ordinance, then the burden of proof will be on the defendant, and the defendant will have to stick to subsection 3A and B. That is, the defendant will have to provide sufficient evidence and have to prove it beyond reasonable doubt. I understand that this will be included in the bill, but this has always been the case in our laws, is that right? Yes, Mr. Wong has it correct. So even if you don't include this part, that's what the court would do, or the standard that the court would follow. My understanding is that the administration is taking the opportunity as it amends the bill to include the defense or exemption clauses here. Well, the burden of proof is still on the prosecution side. It's just that unless otherwise, then the burden of proof may fall on the defendant. Well, I can't say this is incorrect. It's just weird because the legal system has been effective in Hong Kong, and we have always followed the same principle in court. I have dealt with other legislations before, and this type of provisions are often included in other legislations. And this part is about what it means by a reasonable excuse. And this will facilitate prosecution, because in the new 50A bracket 3, it talks about what constitutes a reasonable excuse made by a defendant. That is, the defendant may raise an issue, and if the contrary is not proved by the prosecution beyond reasonable doubt, then it would constitute a reasonable excuse. So the defendant will learn from this provision how he or she can make a reasonable excuse and how he or she can defend his or her own rights and benefits. Ms. Carmen Gan, I thank Mr. Wong for raising the question. We're adding Section 50A here to tell people what a reasonable excuse is. But before this section is amended, this section is called defenses. Instead of the wording reasonable excuse, it says that it is a defense for the person charged to prove that he took reasonable precautions and exercised due diligence to avoid the commission of the offense by himself or any person under his control. So in the original ordinance, the wording reasonable excuse is not used. Instead, the word defenses is used. The original purpose is to ask scheme members to take precautionary measures. So is it appropriate to add a part about reasonable excuse here? In the original Section 50 of the ordinance, back in 2004, when the deposit protection scheme was established, it had already existed. I mean this Section 50. Back then, Sections 13, 15, 46, and 48 mentioned about defenses. Like Ms. Carmen Khan said, this is different from the idea of reasonable excuse. Section 50 is about defenses. It's about taking reasonable precautions and exercising due diligence to avoid the commission of an offense. According to the legal advice we get from the prosecution department, Section 50A is rather specific in the sense that it will only apply in certain special circumstances. Such rules have existed for so long that the principle has not been set out in certain legislations by court. Sections 50 and 50A are prevailing arrangements. That is when a defendant is charged, then the defendant can pick a reasonable excuse to as a defense for himself or herself.
No more questions. Justin, please. On page 19, Schedule 4, there is a reference, contributions to fund. We will also add 58, and there is also an amendment from 500,000 to $800,000. Then moving on to page 25, under what circumstances can we charge the building levy? We need to amend in subsection 9. That concerns the specified amendment. Amendment to increase the dollar amount specified in section 27, brackets 1 or 2 of this ordinance. That's when we can use the build-up levy. We can charge the build-up levy. The next amendment is on page 33. There are also similar revisions. In Chinese, we made a Chinese amendment from 申索 to 表述. That's a Chinese amendment. On page 34, there are also similar amendments. On page 36, also similar amendments. Moving on to page 37, it's about CAP 581 subsidiary legislation A. That's about the membership representations in advertisements. The first amendment is on page 37. It's about a display of a membership sign or a simplified membership sign by a scheme member, regardless of whether it is displayed on an electronic banking platform as defined by Section 3A, brackets 5, or otherwise. There's a new provision about a new simplified membership sign in the case of an electronic banking platform. Page 38, we include both physical banks as well as electronic platforms. So we need to amend the relevant provisions. We have also made a Chinese amendment, and that is just applicable to the Chinese text. It's about the changes to the layout design. We want to standardize the design of the membership sign to be displayed, so we have made the relevant amendments by making clear our requirements. On page 39 of the Chinese marked up copy and page 34 of the English marked up copy, Subsection 1, a scheme member that carries on banking business in Hong Kong and any relevant place of business must. We have added this word. Moving on to page 35, subsection 2. When subsection 1 does not apply to a scheme member, that is specified member, in subsection 3, a display of a simplified membership sign by a specified member on an electronic banking platform, regardless of whether it is displayed under subsection 1 or otherwise, is not to be regarded by itself as information to the effect specified in subsection 2, C, 1, and 2. Subsection 4, a simplified membership sign displayed by a scheme member on an electronic banking platform under subsection 1 or otherwise must be subject to subsections 4A, B, C. In subsection 5, they are about the interpretation of electronic banking platform. On page 37 of the English markup copy, it's about the membership representations in advertisements. For the purposes of subsection brackets 1b, a display of a membership sign or simplified membership sign by a scheme member regardless of whether it is displayed on an electronic banking platform as defined by section 3a brackets 5 or otherwise is not to be regarded by itself as information to the effect specified in subsection 1b, 1 and 2. Another amendment about $500,000 to $800,000. On page 38, section 6A, disclosure as to financial products offered on or after the 1st of January 2011, we have added 6CA after 6C. Next amendment is on page 41. 6CA specifies the circumstances under which disclosure is not required if a person who invests in financial products is a private banking consumer. When the customer has purchased a financial product or has already been told about the negative disclosure requirement, a reminder every month has to be there needs to be a monthly reminder on the client. Ms. Carmen Khan has a question. Well, please explain private banking on page 42, that is private banking. The Hong Kong Monetary Authority has guidelines after all. For example, under the banking ordinance, banks request at least $3 million per customer, or within the bank, investments of $1 million. That is the minimum requirement as a private bank customer. The Hong Kong Monetary Authority has already issued a guideline, so it is not up to the bank to decide on it, despite the fact that these have been written down. Well, there are differences in the definition of private banking or high-value customer. There are integrated factors at play. So, in relation to a scheme member, means the provision by the scheme member of banking or other financial services to individuals who are considered by the scheme member to be of high net worth, but does not include such services so provided as part of the scheme member's retail banking as defined by the specified provision. This is what is written in the interpretation of private banking. Can the Hong Kong Monetary Authority give us more explanations? in order to enhance public understanding of the provision, because we are going to streamline the negative disclosure requirement. We can allow members of the public to have a better grasp of the situation. They will better know whether they are high net worth customers or not. The purpose is to enhance their vigilance. So you would like the Hong Kong MA to tell you more the reasons why it is so written, is that correct? That is because it has nothing to do with customers. We drew reference from the banking ordinance to draft these provisions from the perspective of banks. They differentiate between private bank customers and retail bank customers. Some private banks specialize in providing services to a particular type of customers. Some bank groups provide retail bank services as well as private bank services. In our communication with banks, in their systems, there is a clear differentiation between retail customers and private bank customers. At present, under the Hong Kong Monetary Authority Ordinance, in the course of sale, there are streamlined procedures in the case of private bank customers, so we need to adopt the same set of standards. So it is more convenient and easier for them to identify the simplified or streamlined procedures for a particular type of customers. I welcome using the same set of standards as well. Thank you. Justin, please. We have deleted 3 practice 2, and we have moved it to 3A practice 1. This is on page 43 of the English markup copy. Moving on to page 44 of the English markup copy, there are revisions to the membership signs. It shows the new membership sign. The wording has to be changed from $500,000 to $800,000. There is also a simplified membership sign under Section 3A added. It makes it easier for the electronic platforms to display the simplified membership sign. And there are also amendments to the Chinese text, that is from Sunshot to Biusot, that is representation in English. There is no change in the English text. And on page 45, part 4, related amendments to companies winding up and miscellaneous provision ordinance cap 32. There are some amendments. The first amendment is seen on page 57 of the English markup copy. Practice 13, a note located in the text of this ordinance is provided for information only and has no legislative effect. We recommend moving it to a previous position. Page 58, it's about preferential payments. That is 265. Under 27, bracket 3 of the ordinance, which is also mentioned under section 27, bracket 1, or section 27, bracket 2 of the DPS ordinance, it is subject to the specified provisions as defined by section 27, bracket 3 of the ordinance. Moving on to the next amendment, that is a textual amendment. A reference to the bank ordinance. The that is 21(2)(b) instead of 28(2)(b). The next amendment is the addition of a note that is English markup copy page 72. The last amendment is on page 80 of the English markup copy. A note located in the text of this subdivision is provided for information only and has no legislative effect. We need to delete this subsection and add it in a previous subsection so that it will be applicable to the entire ordinance. And we have already gone through all the amendments. For the remaining amendments, we have already gone through these parts. Legal advisor, any recommendation in relation to the English markup copy? We have looked at the English markup copy. We didn't identify any issues. So any more questions? If there is no further question, we have already finished scrutinizing the bill. So, administration, when will you resume the second reading debate of the ordinance? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member. We'd like to resume the second reading debate as soon as possible. We hope to resume the second reading debate in the first council meeting of July, that is the 10th of July. If you intend to resume the second reading debate of this bill on the 10th of July, I will report to the House Committee on the 21st of June. I will report the deliberation of the Bills Committee and the deadline for moving amendments is 29th of June. That is the deadline for giving notice. Any more questions? No. Thank you for attending the meeting today. Meeting adjourned.